Okay, so for any of you who missed the introduction, my name is Joanne Dyer. I'm a scientist at the British Museum, and I deal with the subject of colour very generally in our collections. And until several years ago, this was mostly dominated by the study of painted surfaces. But over time, this has also extended to the study of historic and archaeological textiles, and particularly since the arrival of my colleague, Diego Tamburini, who is a co-author on this paper. You can see in the photograph over there. And he's an expert in the chromatographic methods for dye analysis. I, on the other hand, I'm a specialist in imaging and non-invasive techniques for the analysis of coloured surfaces. So I think that when Diego and I started working together, we very naturally combined our respective strengths. And we began working and developing a protocol, which, as you can see, combines both non-invasive approaches to give an overview of the textile in terms of production technique, fibre classification, and a preliminary indication of the colourants present, which then allows us to decide on what further analysis is necessary using more invasive techniques that require sampling, such as HPLC-MS for investigating dye stuffs, or SEM for mordant analysis and fibre ID. And in particular today, I'd like to focus on how integrating broadband multispectral imaging approaches into this protocol has been really valuable in this decision-making process because of its very holistic approach. That can not only give us a preliminary indication of those colorants that are present, but they can also tell us about how they are distributed and often even how they are combined. But what are broadband multispectral imaging methods? For those of you that are not familiar, broadband multispectral imaging is a photographic procedure or set of procedures used to observe an object using wavelength ranges that include and extend beyond the capabilities of the human eye. So as a set of techniques, they are used very extensively in the investigation of painted surfaces and ancient polychromy, as observed from the mummy portraits in this example. But until recently, they were not really applied systematically to the study of textiles. So in a typical setup for multispectral imaging, the incoming radiation, so we typically have light in the UV, the visible or the infrared ranges, interacts with the object. Here, for example, we can see such an object in the studio. And in each case, these incoming wavelengths can be absorbed, reflected, and/or absorbed and re-emitted as luminescence. And this outgoing radiation is captured by a recording device. Usually it's a modified camera where the sensor is able to detect wavelength ranges from the UV all the way into the near infrared. And we select the part of that outgoing radiation that we're interested in observing by placing different filters in front of the camera lens. So with this setup, we can collect two types of images: reflectance images, where the wavelength range of the incoming and the outgoing radiation is the same. So these are visible UV reflected and infrared reflected images, and we can create their associated false color images. And luminescence images, where the wavelength range of the incoming and the outgoing radiation is different. So what information can these images provide on archaeological textiles? We're going to use an example. It's this little Roman period sock from Antinoupolis, as some of you may have seen. You saw it earlier in the studio setup and also in the title slide. And perhaps the multispectral imaging technique that is most familiar to textile specialists is UV-induced visible luminescence imaging. So here you are irradiating in the UV and collecting light emitted in the visible range. And of course, as many of you know, lots of organic dyes produce very characteristic luminescence. Madder, for example, luminesces in the UV with very characteristic pink luminescence that we can see in the orange and the red areas. When present in high concentrations, you should note that this luminescence can often be quenched and it can appear darker and even slightly absorb UV. And also that blue emitters like wool or other proteinaceous fibers such as silk can also interfere with the interpretation of the luminescence that we're observing. And for this reason, we often shift the excitation wavelength to the visible when investigating the potential presence of madder. So we use blue light that we can use to target madder luminescence, and also avoid interferences. Luminescence images can also allow us to be looking at mixtures of dyes that may be present. So if we look at the various purple areas that were purple, for example, we can see clear differences in luminescence. So there's quite absorbing areas, and there's also areas that are emitting this weak pinkish luminescence, perhaps indicating the presence of some matter in the dye composition of these brighter stripes. We can also see difference in luminescence in the green areas that appear similar in visible light. And in this area of dark blue, just near the top there, which has, you can see very clearly from this dull blue-gray luminescence, is quite different from the surrounding areas, even though it appeared visibly very similar. And it's very characteristic of the presence of indigo. But when we suspect that mixtures with a blue dye, such as indigo, might be present, like in these purple or green areas, we can use a technique known as multiband reflectance subtraction, which is developed especially to identify the presence of indigo. And this technique takes two images in two specific bands, one where indigo is known to have a very high reflectance, and one where it's known to have a low reflectance, and it subtracts them to essentially give a map of the indigo presence. And you can see the result for that in this image, where the areas that appear bright white are very likely to contain indigo. And of course, they coincide with these purple and green areas, but also with that little blue area that we noted there at the top. Another technique that is very useful in investigating mixtures is infrared reflected false color images. So here we have an image that combines the information provided by the visible and the infrared reflected images into a false color image, where the color is very characteristic of the properties of that material. So in this case, the indigo containing areas appear bright red, but mixtures of indigo and other dyes are also indicated. They're also indicated by different colours, such as shades of salmon in the case of mixtures with yellow, and the brighter orange in the case of mixtures with red dyes, such as madders, which you can see madder just appears yellow in false colour. So just from this very quick look at a few broadband multispectral images, we can already say quite a lot. That madder is likely to be present as a red dye, and also in mixtures with indigo to produce various shades of purple, and that indigo is also present in mixtures with yellow dye to produce various shades of green. And also importantly, where these various dye and dye combinations are located. So these preliminary findings also agreed very well with the results from other techniques used as part of our protocol. So for example, further non-invasive analysis of the samples from orange and red areas showed the presence of madder, and this was confirmed by invasive analysis with HPLC for both the darker red and the orange samples, which were both mordanted with alum. Madder mixed with indigo was confirmed in the purple samples, and indigo with a yellow dye, probably weld, was identified in the green samples, as you can see from the HPLC analysis of a sample from the toe of the sock. And here you have the kind of the table showing the wider analysis and the results. And I think the point to take away from this is that although multispectral techniques on their own cannot provide the level of information obtained from these methods that require sampling, it can, particularly in combination with FORS, be very useful in providing these preliminary identifications, which then guide further studies and minimize the need for sampling quite drastically. Also, because we have this very holistic view, we can start to make relationships between different areas of a textile. So as you can see from this example, you can probably all already see the areas that probably contain indigo in red in the infrared false color image. We can see some faint luminescence due to the madder containing areas. And we can see how brown colored areas that probably contain tannins are absorbing UV. And interestingly, we can also see the difference in response between the different types of fibers present. So blue emitting under UV for protonaceous fibers compared to this beige emission for cellulosic fibres that in this case is undyed flax. We can also start to see trends and relationships between different textiles, as you can see from these examples. All of these examples are from Wadi Sarga. And studies like this enable us to begin to build up an empirical database of the response of dyed and undyed materials in real cases, which can then be compiled into guidelines like this that make interpretation also more systematic and reproducible. So the examples we've looked at so far are quite simple cases, but this approach can also be applied to much more complex textiles and also to different classes of dyes. For example, we recently worked on a selection of 7th to 10th century textiles from Dunhuang in China, and 17 of these were monochrome woven silk textiles, which allowed us to characterize the response after under different wavelengths of light of important dyes such as safflower, gromwell, and yellow berberine type dyes. The multispectral imaging was supported by other non-invasive methods such as FORS, which further deepened this characterization, and ultimately by the HPLC analysis. So this, together with the studies of reference samples, was a good basis on which to work on more complex textiles, such as the ones that are shown here. And again, taking one of those polychrome pieces as an example, we can see that it's composed of a series of colors, some of which are quite hard to distinguish with the naked eye. But under UV illumination, we can see characteristic luminescence, which sets apart the berberine yellows from the non-fluorescing yellows. We can also see the luminescence characteristic of safflower and absorption, likely from the presence of tannins in the brown areas. We can see the presence of indigo, both in its own and in mixtures, from the infrared false color images and from the multi-band subtraction images. And again, similar relationships can again be made between these textiles to create a visual language of how Asian colorants respond to different wavelengths of light. Of course, much of the detailed information of the colorant's presence still relies on further non-invasive investigation with FORS, which is able to confirm the presence of colorants such as gromwell and safflower, and to resolve some of the question marks over dyes that have similar responses under certain wavelengths of light. But ultimately, we do need some sampling to obtain information at the species levels, although this, again, is drastically minimized by having this very holistic overview. So one very important point in the integration of multispectral imaging methods into any protocol is that in order to make the kinds of preliminary assessments and the visual comparisons between different pieces, the acquisition and post-processing of these images must be very highly reproducible. Otherwise, these comparisons are really meaningless. So there are many factors that can affect the quality and reproducibility of multispectral images, but in particular, inhomogeneous lighting, poor color calibration, and sources of ambient light can lead to poor quality images that are difficult to reproduce and also interpret. So to address many of these issues, optimized methodologies for the acquisition and processing of images were developed as part of a European-funded project called Charisma, which happened a few years ago. And the outputs of all of these are available for free open access download online. And in fact, they're currently also being revised and updated. So this research was carried out just a little over 5 years ago. So we're currently revising those protocols, as you can see. And as you can see from these incredible examples of polychrome lasers from the Metropolitan Museum's collection, they can really make a huge difference in how the textile is viewed. So to sum up, multispectral images methods can offer many advantages in the study of textiles. They're non-invasive, they're relatively inexpensive, and they're quite portable. And they provide maps of the photoluminescence and the reflective characteristic techniques of textiles under different wavelengths of light, which can give insights into the chemical nature of the materials that compose them and give preliminary indications, aiding and planning more targeted sampling strategies. In using multispectral imaging techniques, it's very important to consider that standardized acquisition and post-processing methods are crucial in making these accurate interpretations and comparisons between objects, and that they're particularly valuable when integrated into a wider protocol such as this one. So just a little sneak peek at what we'll be using the protocol to look at next at the British Museum. We have an exhibition on Peruvian textiles coming up. We are continuing on our Pacific bark cloth projects, and also because we potentially have angles of investigation into the Silk Roads, we're also looking at the later Silk Roads and synthetic dyes as well. So that's just a hint. And that leads me to thank a few people, particularly the curators of the two textiles collections that I featured in this tour. Also, Chiara Romano and Nobuko Shibuyama, who I worked with at the Met a few years ago. And finally, I know that I whizzed through that. There's a lot in there. So if you want to know any more details, do please look up these resources. And do feel free to get in touch with me also anytime. And many thanks for your attention.